For Crema Media's Polity, I'm Sane Dlamini. Author and journalist Evelyn Groenink discusses her book titled Incorruptible. The book tells of the story of the political assassinations of the three brave freedom fighters, Dulcie September, Anton Lubowski, as well as Chris Hani. But Chris Hani's story is well known to our country. Could you please tell us more about Dulcie September as well as Anton?
Yeah, I must first say that I also came across other murders that I never went looking for. But whenever I was talking to people about these murders, sometimes I would get a response that, no, but it happened to this guy as well, and this person was also in trouble because of similar things, you know, corrupt deals, arms deals, that they had to be removed, which is my conclusion in the three cases. In the cases of, but they didn't all fit on the front of the book, so I stuck for the front of the book with the three well-known names, which I focused most on. Dulcie September was the representative of the African National Congress in Paris, France, in the late 80s. That was before the ANC was unbanned. So she was representing the liberation movement there in France. Anton Lubowski was a high-ranking SWAPO member who was very active, very brave. He was a human rights lawyer who defended a lot of people, including the Upington people who were facing, you know, the protesters who were facing the death penalty at some point during the late 80s. And then when SWAPO was about to welcome the leadership back into the country on the eve of independence in 1989, his house, his own house, served as a welcoming point, and everybody met there, and it was a good man.
In your research for the book, how did you go about unearthing the information about these assassinations?
It was very funny that actually I went totally down the wrong path. And actually the facts had to smack me in the face before I finally realized that I should learn to be an investigative journalist, because I think I wasn't a good investigative journalist when I started. I just started to believe what everybody believed. The dominant story was that, of course, there are these white minority regime apartheid death squads, and obviously they kill progressive people, ANC people, black people. We don't have to ask who or why, because this is normal. They do that all the time. And it's true. I mean, the apartheid regime did run hit squads and they did kill activists. Only they did that mostly in South Africa itself and in the frontline states where the liberation movement, Umkhonto we Sizwe, was carrying out armed activity against the apartheid regime. I found out, and it was very hard, and it took me a long time, as I said. It took me 2 years to realize that they actually didn't do that in France or anywhere else in Europe, because there was a whole narrative was also spread, and I later found, partly by the French secret services, but also encouraged by the South African government, which was still an apartheid government at the time, but even also by the ANC itself, the narrative was that, no, look, there are these death squads, and they did this, and they shot at this person in Belgium, and they try to kidnap people in London, and there is this horrific death squad that does all these things. And I traced every single message and media piece that I could find about this, but there was nothing in each case. And in each case, nobody got hurt. The only person who got hurt was Dulcie September. She was very professionally assassinated. And somehow these other cases, it didn't happen, or it was a mistake, or the people got efficient or lazy or invisible. It just didn't happen. So I had to look at why Dulcie. That was now in 1990. In the meantime, Anton Lubowski had been killed in Namibia. And I found, strangely, the name of the same French arms dealer in the context of both these assassinations. So that is when I started to focus on what had these people actually been doing, and why would people involved in corrupt deals and arms deals be upset with these two.
Could you tell us more about your collaboration with other investigative journalists in writing this book?
I think I benefited a great deal from people who unearthed arms deals in general, people like Andrew Feinstein, who used to be an ANC member of parliament, but who had to leave, is now in London fighting international arms deals and writing books and making movies about it. He actually created my awareness, helped create my awareness that arms deals are an international scourge and corrupt deals also involving, we saw deals in this book also involving oil and diamonds and stuff. And really, if it wasn't for other journalists, Andrew was not a journalist, but then of course you have the Mail and Guardian people and investigative journalists in France and elsewhere who have been unearthing this type of corruption. And then when you start reading books about these things, you realize that no, there is so much money at stake, there's so much power at stake, because they were basically trying to international players with connections to very important companies and governments, including British Aerospace, the one that sold us our jets during our famous arms deal here in South Africa. So it wasn't only the French, it was also the British. You realize that they want a government in South Africa that buys their things, that is their friendly government and buys their things. And then you see that the ANC doesn't really, as an organization, fight that. That is actually the saddest thing.
Mm. What was it that drew your attention to these three particular assassinations, given the vast number of killing of activists by the apartheid regime?
It was Dulcie September, who was killed on the 29th of March in 1988, that shocked me. And then I was still, believing, as I said, that narrative that it must have been an apartheid regime, white mercenary, racist death squad that did it. It was just that I couldn't stomach. I was a journalist, even in the beginning, I think not a very good one, and a sympathizer of the Dutch anti-apartheid movement when this happened. And this happened in Paris. It was very close to us, you know. Paris is 500 kilometers from Amsterdam. It is less than Johannesburg and Durban. So you are totally in a mindset whereby you are extending solidarity, rallying support in the Netherlands for the struggle against apartheid far away. All of a sudden, these monsters that you're fighting far away, they are next door. They're killing a nice lady who used to be a teacher, who is not involved in any armed activity, who is just bringing the ANC's message to the people of France. And then they shoot her with 5 bullets in her face. So I was very shocked, and that is why I started it. I never thought I was going to find more murders after that.
Chris Hani's assassination in 1993 had the potential to destabilize our country's attempt to a democratic breakthrough. Do you feel that the forces behind his killing have been fully exposed?
No, they haven't. If you read the book, you will see that I come to the conclusion that the story that the police have told the South African public is in fact a lie. And the chief inspector of the murder and robbery squad that was in charge of investigating the Chris Hani murder actually told me this. He did not say lie, but he said that, yes, this is probably not the truth. He said, for example, that it wasn't Clive Darby Lewis who was steering, being the mastermind of Janusz Walus, the guy who allegedly shot Chris Hani. He said the chief inspector, Michael Holmes was his name, told me that actually Janusz Walus was the initiator. He visited Clive Darby Lewis all the time, a number of times, to ask him, please get me a gun. Which is very weird, because Janusz Walus worked in a gun shop and he had all these police and secret service contacts. And I think somewhere in the docket it said that he owned 4 guns. So why does he, if he wants to shoot Chris Hani, why does he need this old conservative fuddy-duddy? Because that's what Darby Lewis was, actually, to get him a gun. And then Clive Darby Lewis, of course, and the people who organized, who were behind Janusz Walus, which I also talk about in the book, they knew this, that Clive Darby Lewis' only contacts who own guns are those right-wing Afrikaner Widerstandsbeweging people like Piet Skeet Rudolph, so that he's obviously going to get a gun from there. Where else is Clive going to get a gun? So in the end, Chris Hani was shot with one of those Pitskit Rudolph guns, which created the narrative that this was a white right-wing plot by those Eugene Terre Blanche type people. Whereas in fact, Janusz Waluz was linked to police, secret service, arms dealers, strange, shady cross-border chemicals transporters. His diary is full of these contacts.
But have you had any feedback from the ruling party, the ANC, since this book was published, or even the SACP?
There have been SACP comrades who are very worried and who I have talked to, but there has been nothing official. And from the ANC, absolutely nothing, not a peep.
We have been reminded of the important role of women in this book since you've touched on Dulcie September. Recently, we also lost late Mama Winnie Madikizela Mandela. Can you reflect further on the role of Dulcie September as a leader in our struggle?
Well, first, let me tell you that I don't want to compare Dulcie September to Mama Winnie, because Dulcie September was, as everybody will tell you who knew her, very firm in her mind. She did not go from doing one thing to doing another thing, which is what Mam Winnie is being accused of. Mam Winnie was very brave and participating in popular protests and suffered more than any human being can possibly endure. And maybe this is why, at the end of her life, I mean, we have to face this, she became damaged. She went haywire. People were terrified of that Mandela football club. She didn't want to distance herself. She started saying things like, I am the ANC, and anything that's good for me is good for the ANC. She was friends with diamond smugglers, who were also friends, strangely, with that arms dealer that I talk about, Alain Guénon. Actually, she was friends with Alain Guénon because he pretended to support her. I don't mean to rubbish the value and the heroism and the courage and the sacrifice of Mam Winnie, but she became damaged in the end. Now, what happened to Dulcie September is a completely different story. But I think where the two have, where there is a parallel, is that it is easy to either drown a woman in silence, as happened with Dulcie's murder. I think if it was a man, maybe it would not have been as easy for the ANC, for ANC people like Aziz Pahat to say, no, she was a drama queen, she was always protesting and complaining. Well, she had something to complain about, right? She got five bullets in her face. So I don't think that would they would not have been so dismissive if it has been a man. And in the case of Winnie Madikizela Mandela, I also believe that there have been male comrades who have also become damaged and violent and responsible for killings and, you know, too much violence. You can think of Harry Gwala in KwaZulu-Natal and other people like that. And they have not been as targeted as Mam Winnie was. So in that sense, yeah, as a woman, you always have it more rough, right?
Lastly, what else do you think people will take from this book, and who do you think should be reading it?
I wish that the people who are invoking the memories of people like Chris Hani and Winnie Mandela and other heroes of the struggle, even Nelson Mandela, people who yearn back to a principled human rights, social justice, anti-racism stance, that they should read this book, because that is what these people were. They were principled, they were human rights activists, they were brave, they would never be corrupted. That's why it's called Incorruptible. And if you compare their stance with, you know, what we have seen in the past 9 years, the state capture, the chowing of money that is meant for sick people, poor people, homeless people, if those who are angry about that, if they can read about the example of people who fought these kinds of developments, even from the late 80s, they will feel inspired and they will find some guidance, I hope.
Thank you. That was Evelyn Groenink speaking to Krima Media's Polity about her book titled Incorruptible.